Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I'm Richard Swann, Managing Editor for News in Europe, the Middle East and Africa. With so much attention focused recently on the economic difficulties in the US and Europe, we're turning today to the other side of the world, to focus on a country whose thirst for resources has been one of the most remarkable stories of the last 10 years, China. From building new power stations at breakneck speed to flexing its growing muscle in the international oil arena, China has been all about growth, with a seemingly unquenchable thirst for raw materials to fuel its booming economy. Joining me today to look in more detail at what exactly has been happening in China and the outlook for the economic powerhouse are Ross McCracken, Managing Editor of Platts Energy Economist.
Hello.
And Jimmy O'Connell, Managing Editor of Platts International Coal. So what is driving this tremendous growth in China? Clearly this isn't just a temporary blip, it's not a short-term phenomenon. There must be some long-term trends at work.
From about 2000, China emerged as an industrial powerhouse, and this was a fundamental change in the nature of the Chinese economy and in the energy intensity of the economy. If you look from sort of 1991 to 2000, China was growing fast, but the rate of growth of primary energy consumption was actually about half the GDP growth rate. And in 2000, you see this incredible change. Primary energy consumption leaps ahead of the GDP growth rate. The economy booms, you get a lot more wage earners, and you get an incredible demographic shift, which has created a sort of long-term demand for all sorts of energy across the board, gas, oil and coal.
Clearly this remarkable economic growth we're seeing is underpinned by, or is accompanied by, a rise in energy consumption, particularly electricity. Basic electricity consumption has been really soaring, and a lot of the new growth is coming from coal-fired power, Jimmy.
The most recent report, Richard, from the China Electricity Council, which came out towards the end of July, has indicated that by the end of 2011, the installed electricity capacity of China is going to exceed 1 million megawatts, which is an incredible figure. They're adding the equivalent of the entire British national grid on an annual basis. And this is just current figures. A number of years ago, we'd say 6 or 7 years ago, that would have been as high as 90,000 megawatts a year. This year, it's probably likely to be closer to 80 to 85. The vast majority of that, coal-fired. Despite China, the Asian powerhouse that it is, having truly enormous reserves. Up to 2006, they were a net exporter. They have now turned to being a net importer of coal. They're looking externally for additional supplies.
Mm. And the situation is very similar in gas. And in fact, gas as a commodity has been growing faster because it's come from a lower base than coal. But it actually, even in 2008 and 2009, when growth slowed, the expansion of gas use was fantastic. It was something like 18%. In those years. And this again creates a dilemma. Where is the gas going to come from? The NDRC, the National Development and Reform Commission, estimates that gas demand is going to grow from about 90 BCM a year in 2010 to 200 in 2015 and to over 300 BCM in 2020. That's extraordinary. Yeah. Growth rate.
It's a similar thing on oil. I mean, we've seen double-digit growth in oil consumption in China. Mm-hmm. We've accepted it almost every year in the last decade. Not literally every year, there have been exceptions, but the trend is hugely upwards. They're clearly the world's second biggest consumer behind the United States now. We are expecting growth to slow a little in the coming years. I think it's projected by the International Energy Agency to slow to around 5% a year between mm-hmm. now and 2016. But that's still well outpacing growth in most of the rest of the world. So the focus is all about China when you look at oil demand as well. But is it in the case of China, Ross, do you think this growth in oil is really just about the link between GDP growth and oil consumption? Is there a strict link there?
It's not a strict link, because I mean we saw very high rates of GDP growth earlier in China's development without the same kind of growth in primary energy consumption. But then you have this change where the economy becomes much more energy intensive, and there are fundamental long-term factors behind that. And the first is demography. China isn't, in fact, doesn't have a rapidly growing population anymore. The rate has fallen to about 0.4% a year out to 2030. But 0.4% of a big number, which is 1.275 billion people, is still a big number. I mean, you're talking about the addition of 5 million people each year. But the real change is in the structure of the population. As the growth decline has slowed, you've actually had more adults. So you've got more people of driving age, more people who are making households, who are buying appliances, air conditioning, all these energy consuming devices. These people are also richer. If you look at the Chinese labor force since 2000, the labor force has grown from 700 million people to 813 million people in 10 years. That's 113 million new wage earners. And it's that which is driving energy demand. And on top of that, you have this, probably what is the world's largest mass migration in history, from the rural areas to the urban areas.
One of the most remarkable things, I think, about China's appetite for all these resources has been the way they've clearly not just left this to the free market. They've not just relied on the market to supply them with the oil, with the coal, with the gas they need. Chinese state-owned companies in all of these sectors we watch have been out there actively buying assets, buying opportunities, buying trade deals on a massive level. I know in oil we've seen them, particularly in Africa, there's been a real scramble for assets, but in the Middle East, we've seen them in Latin America, even in Canada, all with a view to securing the resource and getting it back to China. Jimmy, you've seen some of this in coal.
It's been an incredible couple of years in the mergers and acquisition market in terms of both China and India. As much as we said that they were vying for the resources in Indonesia, as in those that are already in production, there is a massive scramble for coal in Asia at the moment. And not only in Asia, again, it's feeding outside of that. But at the moment, it's particularly concentrated around, we'll say, Sumatra in Indonesia, which is very undeveloped in terms of actual resources. We're looking at Adani, an Indian company, a conglomerate, going in there and spending billions and billions of dollars to develop rail networks, to develop infrastructure, to develop mines. In relation to China, we have seen China buy up both existing companies that are producing in Australia, and also we have seen in a remarkable move a couple of years ago, a Chinese company, Shenhua, spent $600 million on basically a plot of earth, virgin territory, unexplored, no data. But it seems to have worked, because in the last couple of, in the last 6 or 8 months, word is filtering through that they're buying farmland adjacent to the property which they acquired a couple of years ago. So it would appear that they have done some exploration and that it's been a good resource to acquire.
Very similar processes in the oil industry, but with an important distinction about how China is going about it. In OECD oil demand, long term, is expected to fall. Asian demand is expected to rise, just much like coal. But in the oil market, China recognises that the bulk of remaining reserves and the bulk of the remaining exporters are held in state hands. So they've tended to take the view that procuring oil supplies is a state-to-state affair. And it's also a way in which they can combat, in terms of competitiveness, the international oil companies. So they've tended to go to places like Venezuela, into Africa, and strike oil deals which secure supply for them and assets, but on the back of loans and financing and other infrastructural developments, and to do this on a state-to-state level rather than the company-to-company level.
One of the criticisms that is sometimes levelled at the Chinese sort of economic growth story is that it's just fueling this huge export economy. They're now the world's biggest export. I think they overtook Germany a couple of years ago. These natural resources that you're seeing being pulled to China, are they just there to fuel these export industries, or is this really about domestic demand proper?
Well, it's been a long-standing criticism of the Chinese economy that it's too export-orientated and doesn't have sufficient internal demand. But I think that's changing. I mean, it's certainly an important risk for the Chinese economy that it's exposed, on the one hand, to raw material prices, which are set in international commodity markets, and then on the other hand, it's exposed to demand in the export markets that it serves. But it is changing, and I think the evidence there is in China's car market. I mean, we've seen incredible growth in the number of cars that China produces. I think in 2006, in the month of January, it was about 500,000 cars. That's not actually produced, that's sold. This January, it was 1.8 million, which is an incredible expansion. But the point about the industry is that only a fraction of Chinese car production is exported. This is about the domestic market.
Oh, it really is.
And as we were saying earlier about more wage earners, more people living in cities, a bigger desire for transport. There's the evidence. These people are buying the cars.
These are real long-term trends you're talking about then. I mean, it's real. You've got domestic consumption really taking off as well. You've got a very strong export economy. There almost seems to be an inevitability about the continued boom of China. But we are expecting oil demand to slow, sorry, growth to slow. It's still growing, but not to grow as fast as it had been. And which way, you know, what's going to happen out there? What factors are there out there that could change the story, like prevent a replication of the last decade in the next one?
Well, there's been a lot of talk, centered around China is going to cap its growth and it's going to slow down its GDP. Well, there's one certain way of actually doing this, and that's making things unaffordable for people again, to stop the growth that Ross has been talking about, particularly, we'll say, in the white goods sectors, the automotive sectors, and particularly the middle class growth areas, we'll say. China's domestic coal prices are at multiple year highs at the moment. We're looking at international coal prices at historically high figures, not actual highs themselves, but quite high historically. So if you have a utility, a power generator that's tied into an agreement that says it's in a position to sell to the grid at this price, and yet its fixed asset costs its input costs are exceeding this, it's going to be operating at a loss. The accountants won't be happy, and it could lead to a real spurt in inflation as well.
There's a very similar situation in the oil market, where the position that oil refiners find themselves in. Oil prices are set in the international market, but domestically fuel prices for diesel and gasoline are regulated. And as soon as you get a volatility or a rise in the international price, then the refiners get squeezed. And in a sense, China has got these coping mechanisms through the power producers and through the oil refiners, in which it's stopping price pass-through, e.g. inflation, into the domestic economy. And whether...
That's a dangerous thing, because if you prevent the feed-through of these price signals to the consumer, you kind of risk fueling...
You send the wrong signals, yeah. Precisely. I mean, it basically fuels growth in oil demand and in power demand, because you're subsidising these commodities. And it's a real balancing act that China has. They have to keep growth high. They can't just curb it, because they have these massive social strains, which are a product of the rural-urban shift. I mean, there's huge change going on in Chinese society. All these people who want to come into the urban economy have aspirations, and they need to be met. So you have to keep growth high. But at the same time, you can't let things overheat. And inflation, in recent speeches by Chinese leaders, has been the top priority. And the reason that inflation is a top priority is because it can potentially spark social instability. So whether China can continue to grow at the same rate is debatable. But one certainty is that as it gets more exposed, as Jimmy said, in the coal market to imports and international prices, and in the gas market and in the oil market, those coping mechanisms with the power producers and with the oil refiners are going to become more and more expensive and more difficult to manage.
Lovely. Very interesting food for thought. Thank you both very much for coming today. That's all from this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse.